Hello and welcome to the sixth lecture from the final module of this course on community rights and forest governance. Having looked at all the spaces in the law for communities to influence how forest land is used, we learnt about some of the skills and attitudes that can help community leaders protect and advance the interests of communities on those issues. In this lecture, we will take a very close look at a case that illustrates some of what we have learnt in this course. In the first lecture of this course, we had noted how the protected area approach to conservation has been criticized for creating pristine islands that not only increase the pressure of human activity on the areas outside it, but also require those living within these areas to pay a very heavy cost. As we have learned already, the laws and procedures related to the creation of inviolate spaces for conservation and forests have conflicted with the rights of forest-dwelling communities under the Forest Rights Act. These rights include their ownership rights over minor forest produce, and their powers and duties to protect wildlife, forests, and biodiversity.
So people often ask that, you know, is this idea of communities managing their forests really a mirage? Is it really a myth? Maybe in the past they never managed, and certainly in the change context of today, which is 150 years later after British rule started, and today the economic, social landscape of the country has changed so drastically in terms of whether it's population growth, economic development, people moving away from forest-based livelihoods and even agricultural-based livelihoods to other kinds of activities. Is it really meaningful to talk about communities managing their forests?
The example that we are going to look at closely in this video is from the Sitanadi and Udanti tiger reserves. These are two adjacent forested spaces in the state of Chhattisgarh, where we can clearly see the conflict between the rights of forest dwellers and the restrictions placed on the exercise of these rights through wildlife conservation laws.
Sitanadi has 17 villages and Udanti has 34 villages. In spite of being a small state, Chhattisgarh has 11 sanctuaries and 3 national parks. If you see this area has the poorest and most vulnerable Adivasi communities. The Kamars, the particularly vulnerable tribal groups, Baiga, Abuj Maria, or Pahari Korba residing in the area.
My village is located in the middle of the Udanti Sitanadi Tiger Reserve. Before 1980, we used to live a peaceful life. We used to collect many different types of forest produce like mohul, that is Bauhinia wahili leaves, tendu, that is Diospyros melon oxylon leaves, amla, that is Philanthus emblica, chironji, that is Buca nania langzan, herbs and tubers. In 1980, the then collector of Raipur, Sri Ajit Jogi, came to Sahibin Kachar to distribute 60 pattas. At that time, forest staff reported to him about an injured wild buffalo lying in a nala. Sri Ajit Jogi, along with the fire watchers of our villages, went to see the animal and observed that the area had a lot of these species and proposed the creation of a sanctuary for its conservation. In 1980, the Forest Department notified it as a sanctuary. Even after that, the community could collect minor forest produce and firewood from the forest and also sell them for livelihood.
Laws like the Indian Forest Act and the Wildlife Protection Act have made people anti-forest. The Forest Act was a colonial law with commercial interests that carved out protected forests, reserve forests, etc. The Wildlife Protection Act created sanctuaries and protected areas aimed to displace people from the forest. This created the conflict between Adivasis and forest. The main conflict was with the Forest Department.
Since 2003, when this forest was declared a tiger reserve, the Forest Department placed several kinds of restrictions, such as on the collection of MFPs, playing music during village functions, and even to the extent that they imposed restrictions on movements between 6 p.m. and 6 a.m. All the efforts of the Forest Department went into keeping the forest inviolate. Before these restrictions, people used to collect resources freely as per their needs. The majority of the population in these areas are tribals and some PVTGs, that is particularly vulnerable tribal groups like Kamar, Bhunjia, etc. are also there in these forests. Their livelihoods predominantly depend on forests for 6 months of the year. Since 2003, the government prohibited the collection and aggregation of minor forest produce like tendu leaves. Our sanctuary area used to have the best quality of tendu leaves. It always got better prices, and we even used to get a good bonus from it. These restrictions have made people economically weaker than before, and now we don't even get much in wages.
Since I started working in the Sitanadi and Udanti areas by organizing communities, I tried to explain to them that their connection with the forest dated back to their forefathers and their association with the forest. In this whole process, people struggled a lot, to the extent that many a times they went to Raipur, Delhi, Bhopal, and continued with their struggles. The enactment of the Forest Rights Act in 2006 gave some hope that the conflict with Forest Department will reduce and that forests and Adivasis will come close to each other yet again. For developing sanctuaries and national parks, the administration wants to displace people and make these habitats inviolate.
Tiger sanctuaries have core and buffer areas. 17 of our villages are located inside the core area of the Udanti Tiger Sanctuary. In all these villages, the collection of forest produce, from tendu leaves to firewood, is completely prohibited. Because I am associated with a Sangathan or group, I get to learn about various laws. Under the Recognition of Forest Rights Act 2006, we had filed claims for individual forest rights. 75 to 80% of the families have received titles to their individual forest rights. We had also filed our claims for community forest rights, but because it is a tiger sanctuary, our rights are not yet recognized. Because these rights are not recognized, we are still struggling for basic amenities like roads, electricity, hospitals, schools, etc. in our area. This is a huge problem.
If poor people are displaced from forests in the name of sanctuaries and national parks, a large number of people, especially in the context of Chhattisgarh, would have no place to go. The Forest Rights Act has a provision under Section 3, Subsection 1, Clause I. The management of forests is enshrined through Gram Sabhas. It is very much possible within sanctuaries and national parks to bring forests and Adivasis closer. Section 3, Subsection 1 and Clause C provides for their rights to own, access, collect, use and dispose minor forest produce. In this area, the collection of MFPs has been prohibited. In this area, the collection of MFPs has been prohibited since 2003. In the Sitanadi Udanti Reserve, the plucking of tendu, that is Diospyros melanoxylon, the collection of mahulai, that is Bauhinia wahili, and mahua, Maduka longifolia, and other such produce has been completely prohibited since 2003. It is ₹450 for 100 leaves of tendu today. But the communities living in the 17 village in Udanti and 34 villages in Sitanadi cannot use this opportunity for their betterment because they cannot pluck these leaves from the reserve. Gradually, this has brought an end to the forest-based livelihoods of these people.
The development of our area was handed over to the Forest Department, and crores of rupees were sanctioned to protect and manage the forests. Under the eco-tourism scheme, the Forest Department, through forest protection committees, facilitated some livelihood interventions like provision stores, poultry, goatry, etc., and then distributed somewhere between 5,000 to 10,000 rupees per family for these trades. The failure was that in all these initiatives, the department did not work in coordination with local communities. Forests belong to the villages, and the people are protecting forests more vigilantly than the department. Poachers, encroachers, and the timber mafia are not bothered about the department staff, but they are afraid of the villagers.
But if the rights to manage forests and to collect minor forest produce are recognized through community forests right under the Forest Rights Act, then the relationship between forests and communities will only strengthen. The main feature of this law, which is that the Gram Sabha will decide how to conserve and manage forests, and the role of Section 4, Subsection 1, Clause E committees, that is the community forest management committees with 10 to 15 members from the villages that will make management plans. All of this can reduce the conflict that the Indian Forest Act of 1927 had created. The Forest Rights Act has the potential to increase community participation in forest governance while safeguarding community livelihoods and conserving forests. Without the community's contribution and participation, we will not be able to conserve forests, reduce displacement, or abate the impact of climate change. Tribals and other marginalized people are already bearing the brunt of climate change.
The villagers are careful that outsiders do not enter the forests to cut trees or kill animals. We know that only if we save forests will the forests provide resources for our survival. The department-driven management has disturbed the whole community arrangement. While buffaloes, which were the natural inhabitants of the Udanti sanctuary, are now endangered, the department is also setting up a wild buffalo reproduction center between Deojhar, Ramli, Bangri Chola and Nage without consulting the local communities. The outstanding problem in our area is that the forest department is driving the whole management in the name of conserving wild buffaloes and other animals, and we are being displaced in the process. But they are hardly succeeding in their efforts. People have also started saying that they will not vacate ancestral villages to facilitate these kind of efforts.
As far as Chhattisgarh is concerned, the government has looked at the Forest Rights Act as just a scheme or program, when in fact it is a law that aims to undo the historical injustice done to tribals and other forest dwellers. It talks about recognizing the rights of people to forests and forest resources which they are occupying, using and conserving. The law is all about the handing over the piece of forest land to people who were receiving their livelihoods from the land. The government distributed 1 lakh or 2 lakh pattas like they were implementing some scheme. They went around counting the number of pattas. How much area was claimed and what rights were requested? This were not even considered. This was not done properly. Section 3, subsection 1 is for livelihoods, and Section 3, subsection 2 for development, which is further enumerated into 13 points. The government before this had granted rights under Section 3, subsection 2 and kept saying that they have recognized community forest resources rights, whereas under Section 3, subsection 1, all rights related to livelihoods, management, spaces of cultural importance, and all other traditional rights were to be recognized.
Under the Forest Rights Act, tribal occupants who had been residing in these villages before 13th December 2005 and non-tribals and other traditional forest dwellers who had been residing in these villages for 3 generations, that is from 1930 onwards, can claim forest rights. Our Gram Panchayat started the process by constituting forest rights committees in which scheduled tribes, scheduled castes and other backward castes were members. We also had women members. The Gram Sabha decided to collect claims from all households residing there before 2005. The forest department had only one patwari to cater to 15 to 20 panchayats for making Nazari Naksha, that is visual maps. He did not have enough time. So we, at our own expense, got the Nazari Naksha made and submitted it to the Gram Sabhas. The respective Gram Sabhas then decided who were eligible, who are non-eligible, and who will go for verification, etc. Almost all the members of the Gram Sabha went for verification of each piece of land claimed. Once the processes at the Gram Sabha level were completed, the whole file was submitted to Gram Panchayat. After completion of the processes at the Panchayat level, the files were submitted to block level committees and district level committees. Finally, in 2008-2009, we received our forest rights titles. In my panchayat, titles were given in 3 stages. With these efforts of the Gram Sabhas, 80% of the households in my panchayat received their individual forest right titles, But this was not an easy task. Because our villages are forest villages and the forest department was not cooperative enough, we had to start a people's movement. We did dharnas, we submitted applications to the collector, SDM and DFO. Today, the community forest rights for our villages located in the core area of the reserve has not yet been granted. Our applications are pending at the block level committee. It's been 5 to 6 years, but there has been no response from the administration.
The government and the forest department is interested in recognizing individual rights only. Community forest rights are not of interest to the state government or the forest department. I believe that only if community forest rights are recognized and livelihoods of forest dwellers secured, will forests be protected. Similarly, displacement owing to protected areas, national parks and sanctuaries will be reduced. We at Community Forest Rights Manj believe that only people's participation can improve the relationship which has been severed for the past 70 odd years between people and forests. Animals and forests will be conserved and protected likewise.
The Forest Department conducted a workshop in our Udanti area on how to implement the Forest Rights Act in 2006-2007, in which they invited only their staff. No one from the local communities was invited. With my little knowledge, I went to all our villages and told them that whoever had been occupying these villages and doing agriculture on this land before 13th December 2005 can file a claim for this piece of land. Different color-coded forms were given for scheduled tribes and OBCs. OBC forms were pink and scheduled tribes were yellow. Along with the claim form, we collected and submitted the required evidence as well. Many such forms were submitted, some were rejected, while some were just not considered. It generated anger and anxiety among the villagers. We were not able to understand why our claims were being rejected. We informed the DFO and the collector and also blocked the National Highway 130 for 9 hours. Then the SDM came and explained the procedures. Then we withdrew our agitation. Some people received their titles while some are still waiting.
Under the Forest Rights Act, 49 Gram Sabhas have received community forest rights. The Gram Sabhas of 17 villages located in Garyaband and Mainpur blocks of Garyaband district and the Nagri block of Damthari district have come forward to conserve forests within the traditional boundaries of their villages. These Gram Sabhas constituted community forest management committees to perform the duties listed and set under Section 5, then measured the traditional boundaries with GPS and carried out forest enumeration to measure density through green points. Community representatives, that is 3 to 4 people, go into the forest to monitor and manage the forest through a traditional approach called Thengapali. A register is maintained in which they keep a record of the animals, birds, poachers, timber thieves that they come across during routine patrols. People feel that there is less food and feed available for wild animals. Very recently, 18 to 19 Gram Sabhas made 2,500 to 3,000 seed balls to be dispersed in the forest. The community believes that once there is enough food and feed for animals inside the forest, the animals will not harm their crops. Some villages like Kamepur and Jalandhi have developed their own nurseries and plan to plant these saplings in empty plots inside forests. Soil erosion is happening along streams and gullies, that is natural drainages, flowing through the forest. This is exposing the roots of vegetation. Gram Sabhas have developed plans to arrest soil erosion and propose boulder checks. They have made proper plans to regulate grazing, regulate firewood collection, to execute thinning to facilitate regeneration in forests, and forests that will be completely conserved and from where only minor forest produce will be collected. They have made rules for collecting minor forest produce. Changes to some harvesting practices had reduced the availability of some MFPs. Gram Sabhas have understood the importance of proper management.
So that was a brief insight into how the forest-dwelling communities of the Sitanadi and Udanti tiger reserves in the state of Chhattisgarh have advocated for a greater role in conservation of wildlife and the management of minor forest produce. We can see how they use their understanding of the law and legal procedures, as well as some of the skills and attitudes that we learned previously in this module, to protect and advance their interests. There are some other examples that we can consider briefly.
The historical example that is quite well known is the one panchayat case of Kumau in Uttarakhand, where because they got these rights to declare a particular area as a one panchayat and then manage it themselves, you can see a lot of forest conservation happened there. Their livelihood needs were met. They managed the forest very carefully. They got a certain amount of income from those forests. And by and large, there have been studies now which show that the community forests are in as good shape as the reserve forests, and the management costs of getting them in that shape or keeping them in that shape are much lower than the state expenditure on reserve forests. So they have been both cost effective as well as conservation oriented or not as state forests. As we know, there are failures in community forestry in one panchayats as well as in the reserve forest context, but the one panchayats do provide many examples of successful management of forests for sustainable use by local communities. The recent examples that are now emerging are from eastern Maharashtra, where through a combination of circumstances under the FRA, thousands of villages have got community forest rights, and several hundreds of them have become very active in exercising those rights, in taking over the management of forest produce and extraction and harvest of forest produce from the forest department, to do it in their own way and to sell it in their own way, to therefore get higher profits than they were getting under the forest department managed scenario. The same produce, for example, in the case of bamboo, villages which were earlier only essentially laborers in the process of bamboo harvest, now that they are owners of the bamboo resource, they have better leverage with the contractors. They have been able to extract better prices, far better prices, sometimes 5 times more than what they were getting under the forest department's pricing arrangements. So they have actually built up a lot of economic capital. Some of them are using it very prudently to then build social capital, train their youngsters to do more forest oriented activities, and so on and so forth. So you see very interesting set of experiments emerging in eastern Maharashtra under community forestry or CFR management under the FRA, augmented by forests that they got under the PESA, and they are trying out various activities. There are, for example, federations that have been formed of 80 gram sabhas in order to do more effective marketing of tendupatta, and they are trying to negotiate with the tendupatta contractors to extract better prices from them. Of course, the contractor lobby is pushing back, but this is part of the whole process of churning of the political economy as communities try to take control of their forest resource. There are examples where highly degraded forests have been regenerated by the community by investing lands, funds from NREGA, funds from watershed development, funds from various other government programs that already exist, in order to really regenerate a forest and make it much more productive than it was earlier for meeting their needs. So you have these kinds of experiments and examples coming up in Maharashtra. There is, of course, also the earlier informal community forestry examples from Odisha, where communities facing a huge shortage of firewood and grazing because of the degradation of forests, thousands of communities set up these small community forestry groups and started protecting and managing that forest resource. Unfortunately, under the implementation of the FRA in Odisha, these community forest areas have not yet been recognized as the informally managed areas have not yet been recognized as CFR areas. One of the reasons being that most of these informal management arrangements came up in mixed communities of Adivasis and non-Adivasis, and somehow the FRA implementation in Odisha is still stuck with the idea that the claims can only be granted to Adivasis or only in pure Adivasi villages, which, you know, is completely incorrect, is an incorrect interpretation of the FRA. But nevertheless, because of that, a whole bunch of these community forests are still outside the purview of the FRA. Hopefully those will also eventually come in, and one will see a dramatic expansion of community forest management in Orissa as well as other parts of central India, where communities in a sense are highly forest dependent, have traditionally used and could potentially manage the forest in ways that, for example, demonstrated by the one panchayats, demonstrated by the new experiments in Gadchiroli and other parts of Maharashtra, and also demonstrated to some extent by the community forestry groups of Orissa.
That brings us to the end of this video, where we saw the practical application of some of the things that we learned previously in this course about the conflict between conservation law and the rights of forest dwellers. we were able to observe how communities in the Sitanadi Udanti area were able to use some of the important skills and apply some of the laws that we have learned previously in this course. Thank you for watching.